Good evening. Welcome to the Raleigh Board of Selectmen meeting for September 26th, 2016 at 7 p.m. at the Town Hall. I call the meeting to order. The first order of business is the Pledge of Allegiance. Barry, would you lead it?
Sure. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, the agenda calls for citizens' query from 7:10 to 7:15 p.m. We have general business, old business, new business, and some minutes to approve. And we're also going to have a presentation by Selectman Snow later on in the meeting. So we'll go to general business number one. It's a request from the Girl Scout Troop 75124 to use the town common for caroling on the common on Sunday, December 4th, 2016. We have Jane White from Girl Scout Troop 75124, 6th grade cadets, has requested permission to use the town common for their annual caroling on the common on Sunday, December 4th, 2016, from approximately 4:30 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. Event coordinator Jane White said that they will have trash receptacles for cocoa cups and other trash. They won't be using candles or other open flames, and she will coordinate with the Raleigh Municipal Light Power to arrange lighting for the event. The police chief, fire chief, highway surveyor, and health agent do not have any comments or concerns about this event. You have any comment? No?
You made a motion, Mr. Chairman. Second.
Motion has been made and seconded to approve the use of the town common for caroling by the Girl Scout Troop 75124 on Sunday, December 4th, 2016. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Hard to believe it. December.
Coming.
Wow. General business number two, we have a request from Pine Grove School PTA to hold the annual Fall Fest on the Town Common on October 30th with a rain date of November 6th. The request from the Fall Fest coordinators Kevin and Ellen Moriarty and the completed application for the use of the Town Common are attached. Below is a synopsis of the key details. And I'll go through that. Date of event, Sunday, October 30th, 2016, from 4:30 to 6:30 p.m. Rain date is Sunday, November 6th, 2016, from 4 to 6 p.m., with the setup beginning at 1 p.m. and cleanup after the event. They estimate 300-plus attendees. There's no cost for admission. Those attending are asked to bring non-perishable food items for the Raleigh Food Pantry. A variety of food will be for sale from food trucks, porta potty delivered on Friday the 28th and removed on Monday the 31st of October, placed against the backstop. Trash and recycling barrels will be in designated spots. Ponies provided by Hunter's Haven Farm, J&J Ponies, individual rider waivers not necessary since ponies and handlers fully insured by the vendor. The PTA is working to secure an insurance certificate naming the town of Raleigh as an additional insured with limits of $1 million per occurrence and $2 million general aggregate. The police and fire chief have no concerns and have confirmed that they will be participating in the event in lieu of a hired police detail. Highway surveyor Patrick Snow asked that all trash generated be removed by the event organizers. Health services coordinator Frank Masciani Said concerns about the portable toilets have been addressed in the letter. Trash will need to be removed at the end of the event, and they will need to issue one-day licenses to the food vendors as in previous years. The selectmen should discuss, clarify the following. Number one, it is unclear where the food trucks will be located. Will they be on the street or on the lawn or the town common? I think we should urge that they be on the street.
I think there's somebody here. You guys here for that?
Yeah. If you want them on the street, that's fine. We didn't have any plans for that yet, so.
Okay. I think because we're a little concerned about
the trees.
Trees and the way the cars were parked on the common that we don't want anybody getting too close to the trees. We have quite an investment in the,
right.
in the town common.
Yep.
So I think if you have them on the street, it would be better. Anybody else for comment?
No, I think it's going well every year. How many years have you done that now?
This is 10.
10. Yeah, so it's been very successful every year. It's a nice feature to have in the comments. So.
Yes, it is.
I'll give you a motion, Mr. Chairman.
I'll second.
Motion has been made and seconded to approve the Pine Grove School PTA to hold the annual Fall Fest on the town common on October 30th with a rain date of November 6th. All those in favor say aye.
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 Very good.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hope you have a successful Sunday and that you don't need the rain.
Thank you. Yes, let's hope. Thank you.
You're welcome.
General business number 3. Approve Halloween trick-or-treating hours for Monday, October 31st, 2016 from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. Police Chief Dumas has set the hours for Halloween trick-or-treating on Monday, October 31st, 2016, from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. Please vote to approve these hours.
Are we scheduled to meet that night?
I do believe.
Okay, this is a question. We come in class.
No, we are now.
I wasn't going to comment. I still won't. I'll accept a motion to approve the Halloween hours of 5 to 7 p.m.
I'll give that motion, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded to have the Halloween hours on October 31st, Monday, from 5 to 7 p.m. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. General business, citizens' query is now open. We will go next to old business. An update on Kids Kingdom Playground Project. The Kids Kingdom Playground is officially open. The Recreation Committee Vice Chairman Tim Southall confirmed that the playground is finished. It has been inspected by Dibble & Sons, Inc. The volunteers held a ribbon-cutting ceremony yesterday on Sunday afternoon. The project is now complete. I apologize, I was not able to attend, but I heard that it was a good afternoon. And
they did a great job over there. They really did. If anybody hasn't gone over, take a ride by someday. You got to go around behind the police station. The equipment looks beautiful. And it's really a nice, really, really a nice setup here. They did a great job, and I think we mentioned last week we'd send them a letter of commendation. But
yeah, Rec Committee is really good.
Yeah, they've done a good job, and yes. Tim Southall in particular bends over backwards to get all this stuff done. So, big thanks to him.
Yes, we do appreciate his efforts on that part. Okay. Old business number 2, Pine Grove School Building Project Update. We have to discuss and vote on the designer contract and discuss bills payable process for the Pine Grove School project. As you know, Brian Forget and Christine Mielen and I went into the Mass School Building Authority to vote on the, we were part of the committee that voted to select Door and Whittier for, as our designer for the Pine Grove School project. And what we're here asking you tonight is to vote on the designer contract. The designer contract is ready for the Board of Selectmen to vote and sign. Chairman Perry will sign 5 originals. Town Council Tom Mullen has reviewed the contract language. The contract follows the MSBA template. While Attorney Mullen did initially request to delete Section 16-2.2, after speaking with the OPM today, he is okay with leaving that provision in the contract and told Debbie that he has no problems with that provision. Could I have a motion to approve of the and sign the contract for Dura and Whittier for the Pine Grove School designer?
Just a question, Joe.
Yes.
On the page 2, on the second page there, you've got to break out of the costs. Now, for Dura, for Pink, it's $227.5, and Dura and Whittier is $425. Are they going to get further architectural appropriations at a later point, or is this, does this design the whole?
My understanding is that they're going to, this is for the feasibility part of the study, and that if they're going to present at town meeting, hopefully in May, for the what needs to be done for the Pine Grove, and then they will get additional
workers. A new contract, right. if it's approved. Okay, that's all. Thank you.
Any other questions? You have a motion to sign the designer contract.
I'll give you a second.
Motion has been made and seconded to approve and sign the designer contract. All those in favor say aye.
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 So, Mr. Chairman, there are 5 originals that the chairman will sign. There's only one signatory line for the owner.
Okay. I can.
You can sign them after the meeting. They will be taken to Dura and Whittier at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, so as long as you can sign them after. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Okay. We have the bills payable process. Because of the large size of the Pine Grove School Building Committee, Debbie has proposed authorizing the following members of the School Building Committee to sign bill payable vouchers. We have 16 members on the committee, and we would like to allow certain people to be signers for bills payable and not have majority sign it. The people are that we would like to name to sign the bills payable vouchers are Chairman Joe Perry, Vice Chairman Brian Forgett, Clerk Cliff Pierce, Larry White, FinCom Rep, and Debbie Egan, the alternate. In the event that any of these members are not able to sign the voucher, Debbie will sign as an alternate. Debbie has run this by Town Council Tom Mullen. He did try to get confirmation from MSBA and left messages with 2 people at MSBA. He didn't get any response. Attorney Mullen told Debbie that at this point he is comfortable with having the selectmen delegate the individuals as proposed. If by the off chance that the MSBA objects, he will get in touch with Debbie.
Sounds good. I'll give you a motion, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. Authorize those people.
Motion has been made and seconded to approve those people to be the signers for the Pine Grove School Building Committee. All those in favor say aye.
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 If Cliff Pierce is on the, is going to be one of the signers, should he be voting?
Well, Joe, too. I mean, if that's the case, but.
That's just a question.
I don't think it's inappropriate.
I don't have a problem with it. But if you think you're better off.
I don't mind abstaining either. We could get 3
Cliff,
votes.
Did you second it?
Yes.
Yeah, so maybe.
I'll second it.
Bob can second it if you two wanted it.
We send the vote and vote again?
Yes.
Yeah. We send the first. I'll make a motion to rescind the first vote.
Okay.
I'll second it.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Now we need a motion.
Make a motion to approve those five people to sign the...
I'll second.
Motion has been made and seconded to approve those five people to sign the bills. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Okay, sounds good.
Cover our bases.
I'm learning.
Thank you, Bernie.
Okay. Old business number three. Discuss designer selection committee for owner's project manager for fire and police station project. In accordance with the designer selection procedures, the Board of Selectmen needs to designate the individuals to be on the designer selection committee for the OPM, the owner's project manager. The DSE will evaluate and rank the firms responding to the RFQ for the OPM for the fire station and police station project. The OPM is not the designer. The OPM provides assistance with writing the bid documents, monitoring construction, interfacing with the designer, serving as the clerk of the works, and closing out the project. The town is required to have an OPM due to the size of this project. The evaluation process should be fairly quick, as this is an OPM services contract. Debbie recommends that the DSE or the OPM consist of three members, one of which should be the chairman of the Board of Selectmen. Debbie is also able to serve on the DSE. So we're going to have, so we'll have, myself will be sitting.
I would recommend that the chairman of the Board of Selectmen serve
and
on...
the town administrator.
If you would like me to serve as a procurement officer for the town, I'd be happy to do that if the board so wishes. But I would suggest one other person. This is, like I said, an OPM contract.
Right.
It's not the designer stage. This is more to handle the administrative piece of things. You know, work from this office that needs to be done, and we're required under state law to have an OPM.
I'm more than happy to serve if nobody else wants it. I've been kind of involved in the project since way back in the beginning. But if somebody else wants it, that's fine, no problem.
That's always a yes. Thank you. Okay, so we'll have the designer selection committee would be myself as chair of the Board of Selectmen. We have Town Administrator Debbie Egan and Selectman David Peterson. All those in favor of approving to that committee? Oh, I'm sorry.
I'll give you the motion, Mr. Chairman.
Getting a little ahead of myself.
Somebody needs to second it.
Could I have a second?
Second.
We have a motion made and second to approve the Design Selection Committee for the owner's project manager for the police and fire station. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
I recuse myself.
Abstain.
Abstain, whatever.
Okay, I hope we get an OPM as good as the one that we have for Pine Grove. They are excellent. I've told them that a few times. Okay. Old business number four, discuss town meeting article for expenses related to the DEP sanitary survey. The Board of Selectmen needed some time to review the Water Department's response to the proposed fall special town meeting article seeking the transfer of $225,000 from the Water Department stabilization account to cover the count a cost for complying with the deficiencies noted in the DEP sanitary survey. Is the board satisfied and can the article be placed on the warrant? Everybody had a chance to read the DEP sanitary survey and the response from the Water Department. Any questions? Any comments?
Just if as long as the Water Board has the money in there. Deficiency fund or excess and deficiency fund, and I would be perfectly happy to vote for it.
Any other comments? Do you have any comment?
I've been told not to say anything since I'm not designated.
Okay, thank you. I'll have take the motion to approve placing the article on the fall special town meeting warrant.
I'll give you the motion, Mr. Chairman.
I'll second.
Yep.
Mr. Chairman, Cliff seconded that?
Cliff seconded.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of placing the article on the fall special town meeting warrant, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Old business number five, discuss location agreement with Bridgewater Picture Finance LLC for the filming of the Chappaquiddick movie. The location agreement needs to be approved by the Board of Selectmen with an authorization for Chairman Perry to sign it. Town Council Judy Pickett has reviewed the agreement and is satisfied. Chairman Perry will sign two originals.
Mr. Chairman, you may only have one original in the packet, so you can sign the second one later.
The motion to sign the agreement with the Bridgewater Picture Finance LLC on the filming of Chappaquiddick at the town hall.
Give you the motion, Mr. Chairman.
Motion has been made and seconded to approve the agreement, signing the agreement with Bridgewater Picture Finance LLC for the filming of the Chappaquiddick movie. All those in favor say aye.
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 Okay. Moving right along, we'll get down to new business. Triton Regional School Committee, September 19th, 2016, Joseph Perry, Chairperson, Raleigh Board of Selectmen, 139 Main Street, Raleigh, Mass. 01969. Dear Chairperson Perry, I am writing to alert you to the fact that the Triton Regional School Committee will be entering into negotiations this fall with the Triton Teachers and Instructional Assistance Associations. In the past, and pursuant to 603 CMR 41.00, the towns have had a representative on the school committee negotiations subcommittee. We anticipate and welcome that again for this coming year. Please let me know if there's anything I can do to assist you in the process of appointing this representative. In the past, Neil Harrington has been approved by all member towns, boards of selectmen, and we would be happy to have him join our team again if he is willing. We don't anticipate beginning formal negotiations until after November 8th, except for a planning meeting to outline the process in mid-October. I look forward to your response. Regards, Dina Sullivan, Chair, Triton Regional School Committee. I did speak to somebody in Salisbury, and my understanding is that Neil Harrington is willing to serve in this capacity again.
Mr. Chairman, I have no objections to that. That's fine. But I think this is going to be an important negotiating session. And I believe from past experience that the high representative doesn't actually get involved in the negotiations. They're there as a representative of the town. They don't actually negotiate with the teachers themselves.
They're not a voting member.
A voting member of that part. So I would request that this board or have the town administrator put together a letter to Mr. Harrington advising him of our budget situation and the kinds of things that I think in the past we've kind of ignored the whole situation, and I think it's time to put something together to advise Mr. Harrington and thus the, and pass it on to the negotiating committee that, you know, we've got some, a number of financial issues in our town. And, you know, the kinds of, we got three contracts going ourselves. And it's important that they keep within common sense bounds in terms of negotiating salaries and money increases. Because as we saw last year, I think around a 3% raise for the school was $1 million, which ate up every bit of our, you know, if it was divided evenly, it eats up just about all of our money the way things have been going. So mm-hmm. I just think it's important that, you know, Mr. Harrington and the negotiating committee, as well as the school committee, I assume, would get that letter and be aware of our financial and fiscal situation, that this is going to be a tough year for all of us, including them, I'm sure. But put it in writing, I think, is critical, rather than just saying, mm-hmm. yeah, go ahead, Mr. Harrington, you can negotiate, and then we sit back until we find out what they got.
I was going to suggest that we do copy the school committee negotiation subcommittee and the entire school committee.
Sure, that's fine.
I think that would be an excellent idea. Because of, as you said, that we are negotiating contracts with the unions in town, and that we have to let them know where we stand on the, I have made an overture to Mrs. McDonald, who is the chair of the Salisbury Board of Selectmen, and we seem to be on the same page, she and I. But we are not speaking for either board, but I've made our concerns.
It's going to be a critical year.
Yes.
Is that a motion?
Yeah, I'll make a motion to that effect.
Second that.
Maybe if the town administrator can get back to us in a couple of weeks with a draft copy or whatever, mm-hmm. sometime before they meet. Yeah, I'll make a motion on that.
I'll second it.
Can you have seconded? Mm-hmm. You have a comment?
Yes. Is there any way of being, I think the sending a letter is very important and a great idea. Is there any way of being a bit more explicit as to what the parameters might be?
Not really. In other words, they're a separate organization. They can negotiate anything they want, although we have to pay the bills. That's why, at this point, and if Joe has been talking to or going to talk to the two chairs of the other two towns, I think that's where we get our strategy moving forward. But at least we get our letter on record with everybody. And, in fact, maybe it'd be, I don't know if you, there was in the motion to make sure that Salisbury and Newbury get a copy of that also. But, you know, we're kind of like just pounding on the door. We really don't have a lot of in mm-hmm. to get in the door. So this letter is the first thing, and I'm hoping that with our chair meeting with the other chairs that furthers that. And then at some point we may be worthwhile going to the school committee meeting and, you know, we see how things progress. So, but that'll be down the road a piece and see how things go.
Right. We do have, we do get a chance to comment and to communicate to the school committee at the district communications meeting. There is one set for early October, but it's to discuss the Triton Regional Agreement. I don't think anything else is on the agenda for that evening, but usually we do have another meeting with the district communications where Larry White usually attends from the finance committee, and other members of the Board of Selectmen show up, and we do communicate to the school committee how we feel about the budget and what our parameters, what our suggestions are in that we're offering part of the 2.5 increase and part of the new
growth
increase, if there is any.
Not much.
And then we offer half of that, and they haven't come in anywhere near that in the last several years. But we can make that suggestion. As far as their negotiations, we don't make suggestions on what they should or should not offer. They're very keen about that.
Yeah, the best we can do is send a letter at this point.
Right.
And follow up afterwards. So see what the response is.
Any other comment?
After that, we have to follow the agreement. And that's why we have to do it this way.
Right. So, all those in favor of sending the letter, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Well, now. New business number two. We have a presentation by Selectman Bob Snow of a tour of the MBTA commuter rail maintenance facility in Somerville. Bob Snow will do a presentation of his recent tour of the MBTA commuter rail maintenance facility located in Somerville.
Well, for the past 5 years, I've been on the MBTA advisory board, and every quarter, I go in town and I sit the advisory board, and that covers approximately 136 towns that are covered by the MBTA. And at those meetings, usually there's about 50 plus people that come to the meetings from different towns. And each, you know, if one of the people at the advisory board, the function is there's something in your town or there's something you've seen, you know, give the MBTA a heads up. So I was called by, I was sent an email several weeks ago by Micah Gensler. And he asked me if I wanted to tour the maintenance facility over in East Somerville. So I gladly said yes. And I went over, and I was kind of taken aback, because when I got there were only seven people showed up. I was one of the seven. Now, this particular maintenance facility, this only does the commuter rail. That's it. Nothing else. So it takes care of the North Shore and the South Shore. Now, the number of trains on the South Shore is about one-third greater than the trains on the North Shore. It's because of the track size and everything else. I think the farthest that the commuter line goes out to Worcester, goes up here to Newburyport, and then goes down to Kingston, Rhode Island, just one stop beyond Providence. So those are old enough to remember. This is the old B&M Railroad system.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And then the MBTA came in and took this over. So I asked, as you can see to my left here, I'm just going to walk you through some of the sites that I saw. And we spent about an hour. The whole time we spent a total of about 3 hours. And we spent about an hour up in a conference room, and we're just asking questions. And one of the questions I asked was, I didn't pussyfoot around here. I said, "How's the morale?" And they just kind of tensed up, and this, you know, and it goes back to the winter of 14-15. I mean, they're still reeling from that winter. That winter, one of the very first things that came right out of their mouths was, "We got new snow removal equipment." They were, you know, emphatic. And there are two gentlemen, their names were Sev Stratluff and Ken Abishon. And they were excellent. And they took us down into the facility. It's a huge facility. I was very impressed with it. So if you look over here to the left, on my left, and you see the very first slide, and those are the trucks, what they call, those are the wheel bases, and you'll see at this wheel base over here, we'll go to the next slide, you see the difference, that's for a regular commuter, commuter car, and the one before it, this one here, that's for the double-deckers.
Oh,
so
yes.
You can see it's much, much heavier base. So in the facility, what they can do is they can take the car, bring the car in, lift it up, and get these trucks right out from underneath it. They can go to work on it, bring another truck in, you know, that's been repaired, and they can move that car out and get it back into service. It is a huge operation when you really see what they have to do every day to get trains going. Now, we'll go on, but just to give you some background, there's 420 coaches, and there's 60, then there's another 61 that are inactive. Locomotives, there are 125 locomotives. And then we'll go down here, we'll go forward, and you'll see, okay, that's the, in the pit, they were doing, this was electronics, they were doing, performing on the cars, and I was very impressed with the operation. We'll go down a little bit further. And that's one of the old, that was a Canadian engine. That's about 20 years old, and that's still in service, still used to pull the commuter rails. And then, as we're walking through, and this is the yard engine, and that's, I don't know how many years old that is, but that just pulls the commuter rail, the cars around the yard. And to get the cars from the South Shore over to, you know, I was thinking, I said, how do they get them over here? Well, there's a piece of track, old B&M track, over by BU, which they bring the cars over from the South Shore. And as you can see, that's one, I think that's one of the older cars.
No, that's one of the new ones, isn't it?
Is that what might be one of the ones
they just bought
tell.
Last year. It's a little tough to see it. But.
And they bought 40 of these new cars, and they had some problems in being, yeah, there it is right there. You can see it. And these are the MPI HSP46s and the engines that are used inside, the GE engines. That's one of the very first things I asked. I said, these made in America. But, and then going forward, as you can see, it's like a spaceship inside, kind of very high tech. The engineer, he's responsible, or she's responsible for the running of that train. And they took us right in. We got right into the diesel engines. I got to walk into the compartments, see the compressors. I was very impressed with it. And then Svev, he took me and he showed me about the wheels and how they repair the wheels, and you know, doing the maintenance. And he showed me some of the pits on one of the wheels, and he showed me how they grind them down and how they test them, and it was very interesting. And then they took us down, we went down, and this part of the facility I found very interesting, because they got to bring the train in, and depending on whether it's for, they can, these engines can pull four coaches, eight coaches, and depending on what line they're running on, they have, where the train is going to go. The train will come in here, and that train will be looked at, for the electronics. It'll look at for the Wi-Fi. They're tested. They'll empty the toilets. They'll everything is done on this track, and soup to nuts to get that train out and running. And this fellow was showing us about looking at the brake system, taking us down inside. And that's just the coupling, and you can see, the coupling is above. Those are the two coaches brought together. And that was in the next rail across the way. As you can see, this is a big facility, and there's two more of these tracks like this off to the right. And then this is, as you can see, that's the size of the building. That's one side I took a picture of looking out. But I was very impressed with the facility. There's a lot when you get on that train in the morning, and you take for granted to get that train up and running and get it into Boston and back. And some of the things they were telling, besides they bring it down that track, they fuel it up, and it's fueled up for 2 days. And I was very glad that I got to walk through. It gave me a great appreciation for it. I love the T. I think the T is great. And train system, if you've got to go in town, that's the way to go. But I just wanted to give you appreciation for the commuter rail line. And it's now being run by Keolis. It's a European company. So there's a lot going on with the T right now. But commuter rail, that's the maintenance facility for that. The orange line has their own, the green line has their own, the red line has their own. So it is a big entity. So, they have a lot of problems, but they're trying to address them. And Anyways, that's...
Some of the numbers that you give, they have over 400 cars.
400 cars.
And over 100 diesels.
If you look engines. At the, if you, you know, just open up and look at the rail system for the, just the commuter, you could realize how big a system, you know, they're running. And it's, again, it's the old B&M Railroad.
Wow.
Basically. Wow. And again, they had 125 locomotives. They have four that are that they'll bring in and out of service, and then there's another 36 that are inactive. And again, each one of those 4 to 8 coaches, they carry anywhere between 400 to 1,400 passengers. And if you've ridden on the new double-deckers, I mean, they're really nice to travel into Boston. And that's it. Any questions?
Just a few comments. I grew up in Cambridge where the MBTA was our mode of transportation. And I had a bus service right there at the house and was able to walk across BU Bridge right onto Comm Ave to the Green Line. And it's just amazing what they do for a service. We could get down to Forest Hills. We could, of course, back then, when I was a kid, we only could get out to Harvard Square. That was the end of the line. And we could get all, in the wintertime, they didn't go all the way out to Wonderland because it was snow and ice on the road. But now it's changed quite a bit.
Just a little background on the two fellows who took me around. One of them had come out of Amtrak and come into the Green Line, and they did some work on the Orange Line. Then he came over into the commuter rail line. So they had he had over 20 years in the rail business. And the biggest thing that they really, when I asked about morale again, was the snow. They were just like on pins and needles. And I think they're holding their breath as they go into, if we have a bad winter this year. But it sounds like they brought in a lot of snow fighting equipment. So we'll see.
Excellent. Okay. Hopefully everything will go well and hopefully. Go better than it did in 14-15 winter season. That was a tough year. That
sure was.
A really tough year. Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Okay, moving on to new business number 3. Discuss expanding playing fields at Pine Grove School and purchasing adjacent lands. If the Board of Selectmen is interested in pursuing the purchase of land contiguous to the playing fields at the Pine Grove School as part of a unique property acquisition, then this land will need to be appraised. Debbie has obtained a quote of $3,400 from William LaChance to appraise the land. If the board wishes to proceed, then they need to vote to send a letter to the Community Preservation Committee asking for this expense to be covered under the CPC administrative budget.
What is a unique property acquisition? Is that a term of art?
It's a term that, in other words, is normally when you're going to buy a piece of land, you go out to bid. This here, there's one piece of land that's adjacent to the others over there that are already there, and it wouldn't do any good to buy a piece of land up on Railroad Avenue. It just short-stopped the process of going out to, you know.
So we don't have to go out to bid for this?
Apparently that's the way it works, Debbie, right? If they approve, it gets approved.
Exemption in 30B, Section 16, real estate procurement, that if there's a unique property acquisition, usually it's tied to open space or park land, in this case, active recreation park space. To file as a unique property acquisition.
This project goes back 2 or 3 years. It's part of the Brad Street Farm. In fact, it came up the other night at the CPC meeting. I was watching it on television. Mm-hmm. And there's $208,000 left in that account. But what originally we, Meridian Associates, designed a ball field for the Brad Street property down and back between the Pine Grove School and the conservation land. But what developed was when Meridian went over there and did test borings, and it's a horrendously difficult piece of land to build anything on. It'll require that when they did test borings, they discovered that the quality of the soil was really bad. The water table was very close to the surface, and it was going to build a decent ball field. It was going to require about, they guessed at that time, Without labor, just materials, probably $225,000 worth of materials to bring in to make that area playable. And then you add the cost of the construction part of it, which is probably another couple hundred thousand dollars. And then we had appropriated, I think, $225,000 to actually construct the ball fields. So at that time, it was Tim Southall, myself, Debbie, I think Bob might have been, were you on that too, Bob? We were on that committee then, and we decided that it was to go well over $500,000 for a little league field was just kind of ridiculous. So as part of that, we looked at, if you go over behind the Pine Grove School, the town over the years has bought two pieces of property that we now use for soccer fields, basically. And the Gwynn property is adjacent to it, and it runs over behind the historical house that Bob is aware of. And it's, I don't know, 3 or 4 acres, I'm not sure exact acreage, but it's a prime piece of flat land, there's no trees on it. And apparently there might be a willingness for them to sell that piece to the town to hopefully expand the ball fields. And if we can do that, we can probably use, we won't need that whole 220 probably to develop those fields, we can use some of that towards the purchase price. But so that's where the money that sits in the CPC fund reserved, that's why it's there, because we declined to build the field at the time. So the other issue we have is that when we talked about the water board, DEP for years has wanted us out of the Little League fields over by the Agawam-Dinah.
Yeah.
We've kind of always put it off. Well, the DEP now is kind of saying you guys really need to get out of there. So as part of the time I met with Mary Beth, the idea was to give us a couple of years to hopefully purchase this property behind the Pine Grove School, because the two pieces we have there are not quite big enough by themselves to put a little league field. Plus, if we put a little league field there, we're going to be eliminating some soccer fields. So basically, and one of the things I brought up before, we've been talking about CPC funding, is we're going to lose a little league field. We're going to lose a baseball field. We really have to look around at purchasing some athletic field land, because we haven't bought any new land for athletic fields in years. The programs are growing by leaps and bounds, and this is one that we really need to move forward on and ASAP, so that hopefully we can go before the spring town meeting for whatever the purchase price would be for this property adjacent to the property we have. And that's why it's a unique acquisition, because it's the only, we can't go anywhere else. It's adjacent to that property. And
well, you're saying the town needs an additional site besides this property?
Well, we need to do this. If we can get this site, we will be able to basically, this will be a wash, because we're going to lose the Little League field on Haverhill Street. So the Little League field will go over there. When we put the Little League field over there, we're going to lose one, maybe two soccer fields, which if we get this land, we can put on that land, and hopefully there'll be a little more space, but we're not going to gain a lot of space. All this is going to do is kind of keep us up to what we currently have
for recreational use.
And I seriously would encourage this board, as well as the CPC, et cetera, to be looking around to less about open space and more about land for playing fields, because
soccer fields
are, they do, there's so many different sports going now that, you know, it's just something that we need to really be looking at. And this is the first step. And it's taken a long time, because we actually had drawings made for the construction of that field on Brad Street and everything else, and then we discovered that the property was needed so much infrastructure money. We just sat back and just kind of with everything else going on, it just goes slow, as we all know. These projects take time. So what we're looking for here is to go to the CPC, ask for the $3,500, get the property surveyed or assessed, and then we can get together and see about actually purchasing it after that, once we got an assessment that we can work with.
Do we want this money before the fall town meeting, or do we want to?
Well, if we could,
appropriation
if,
be made
if we could
town.
Do that, I think that would be great.
The CPC would have to meet again.
Well, I think you might have to anyway, because I think the other night when I was watching TV, the CPC appropriated $100,000 for the Mahaffey property.
Yes.
And I think we need $450,000, because we have to have $450,000 up front, and then we'll get reimbursed from the state if we get the state grant, and we'll get reimbursed from the Greenbelt. So I think that vote needs to be changed anyway to 450, not 100.
Well, the approval at the CPC money that was requested by Greenbelt was for $100,000 commitment from the town.
Right.
And that could be reduced to $89,000, depending upon if they got the grant. But if the grant did not come through, Greenbelt would seek to raise the additional $350,000.
Right, but the way the whole thing works and the way we've done it, if the state wants us to purchase the property or purchase the CR in this case, and then they will reimburse, they will not give us $300,000 to put in the bank and use it when we feel like using it. When they give us that money, if the grant goes through, it's to reimburse us for money we've already spent. And the same thing with Greenbelt. I mean, I'm not sure. If you look around, Greenbelt's got, they're looking for money for big land acquisitions in Amesbury now. They've got a big land acquisition they're looking for in Ipswich, amongst others, I'm sure. And so I imagine unless they got some deep pockets somewhere, it may be a little time before they raise the money they need. So it just check on it to make, I'm pretty sure, as I understand from my past experience here, is we have to come up with $450,000 and then have the article worded in such a way that we get reimbursed. It'll go back to, but in the initial town meeting vote is going to require $450,000.
The original presentation by Vanessa Johnson was that we would put up $450,000,
right,
and that the town would be would put up $100,000, that we'd get a grant.
Right.
But the request that she made at the CPC money,
yeah, I didn't quite understand that.
Was for only $100,000.
Yeah, I think she, I'm not going to characterize it, but in my understanding, and the town administrator can check on it. I did talk to Karen O'Donnell today. That I believe we need to appropriate 400. In fact, if the original article wording she had was for 450,000.
Mr. Chairman, the town council is currently working on this right now. So there is a phone call, or there'll be some phone calls or emails into Vanessa Johnson at Greenbelt this week.
Okay.
So Brent and Judy Pickett are working on this right now, because that was the first question that came in reviewing that draft warrant article. And my understanding was that it was contingent upon receipt of that grant. There would be no transaction or passing of papers or anything after town meeting until that grant came in.
And
so that's the language we're going to need to sort out, I think, over the next couple of days while we're working on this.
But the bottom line, Joe, is if the CPC, if we should ask the CPC to meet again. I mean, there's plenty of time between now and the time we put the warrant together to ask for. They may be able to vote on it without even just take it out of their administrative fund. I'm not sure what the logistics are there, but yeah, the sooner we do this, I think it's a priority, because what we'd like to be able to do is come Springtown meeting is if we reach an agreement to purchase that land, that we would then go to the CPC for
right.
whatever funding we'll need to actually go through with the purchase.
Well,
so you want the
Cliff's on the CPC
right.
with me, and my understanding back last spring was that the Greenbelt was coming in asking us to appropriate $450,000
right.
and the $100,000 in the state grant. But then I was surprised at the when I saw the agenda for Thursday's meeting that they were coming in and they were requesting a warrant article asking for $100,000.
Well, the thing was, she even said at the minute, I watch it on TV because we can't go, three of us can't be there, but on TV she basically said that if the state grant doesn't come through, that the Greenbelt would raise more money to make up for the lack of funding from the state.
Right.
The only thing is, I believe the Mahaffey Tenney Trust has a time frame of their own to get this deal completed. Otherwise
maybe.
It's gonna, but she kind of glossed over that whole thing the other night. And we can easily check on that. But I think it's a matter of, I would check on it just so that, or if Judy Pickett's going to give us, I'm sure she'll let us know.
We're working off the draft warrant article that the board approved that was in the grant application package. So there's
you know, we are working on it.
Yeah, there's plenty of time. We're not on the plan here. It's just a matter of, we may well have to have a seat.
But I'd like to ask Cliff, was that your understanding? Was I correct in my appraisal of what happened, what we voted?
Yes, right. Yeah.
That we voted to approve 100,000.
Well, we, I can't remember exactly how we worded it, but we may have put it that our maximum, subject to the condition that the town's maximum contribution would be $100,000.
Right.
But I don't know if we voted to authorize 450. We probably didn't.
No, we didn't. It was strictly the 100,000, up to $100,000 for.
Right.
So, you know, that's a different issue for the CPC to deal with. But I would say that if CPC meets, then we should have this on their agenda. I think they could just give us the okay. It doesn't even have to go to town meeting. I think it's just money that they have in their administrative fund. They just have to authorize us, give us authorization to spend, which we've done in the past with other pieces of property. We did it with the Girl Scout property. We did it with a variety of pieces that we've done this for, because we need to have an updated appraisal.
So should
we can do anything.
Send a letter to the CPC to request a...
No, I think that would be appropriate.
So, Mr. Chairman, if this board would like to vote to authorize, you know, request these funds so that we can, you know, pay for this appraisal, we can get a memo over, and then when they can meet as soon as possible, because I have a timing...
Right, they have to post it in the newspaper.
Okay, and we need to get this appraisal done in order to meet the timetables that we'd be looking at for a spring town meeting.
Right.
Because there would be, after this, there's other steps in this kind of transaction.
I don't remember quite how large the soccer fields are back there currently. They're junior-sized fields, so they're not full-size fields. Is that correct?
They're
small fields.
They use a variety of size fields. I believe the one that's currently over in use at behind the Pine Grove School is the full size. That is the full size field. I believe the smaller fields they use up at Harris Park. So that this is where we're eliminating the one full size soccer field that we have. Yeah, it's pretty close to a football field, not exactly, but it's, you know, you're talking
wider than a football field.
A little wider, but I mean, it's a.
So, and that the property that we're acquiring is large enough, the footprint to the full size.
Yeah, I'm going to say. I looked at the drawings before I come down, but I think the whole property is like 5 or 7 acres, and we'd be taking the back three. But combined with the other two parcels we have, would be more than enough room to at least replace what we're losing by putting the Little League field there. And hopefully, and I keep my fingers crossed when I say that, until a designer looks at it, it would be not great if we could get another soccer field over there, or, you know, they play lacrosse now. I mean, there's so many different field sports that are being played that, you know, we really desperately need the fields. And
there's a real shortage of soccer fields.
Yeah, mm-hmm. No, there definitely is. So, and I, you know, maybe with Triton, you can use their field. I don't know how they're doing it with the charges, if they're going to charge the local towns, leagues.
Governor Dama charges something like $100 and $150 an hour. So since a soccer game is an hour and 40 minutes, you have to pay $300 a game. That's a lot.
Yeah, no, it is. And Triton was going to work a deal with the towns. I don't know. I don't remember what, I have no recollection of what we actually talked about.
Yeah, I have no idea what they...
You know, we could at least get some use up there if we could, that, with artificial turf, that'd be great. But in the meantime, we really need to develop fields within the town.
And
we'll lose it, because we're losing that Little League field up there. It puts us really under the gun.
Would be okay with... I mean, that was one of the problems with playing at Governor Dummer. We couldn't start to play until after the staff wake up, which on a Sunday would be 11 or 12 o'clock. So that puts a crimp in the use. So, I mean, how...
That's a whole different issue. I don't think it's a problem now, and it would be in the purchase and sales agreement, I suppose, that would be how that's worked out in a purchase and sale agreement if they wanted to put a restriction on there.
Okay. I don't mean to speed things up, but I would call for a motion to ask the CPC to meet as soon as possible and to discuss, put on their agenda the money, the $3,400 to do the appraisal for this purchase of the Gwynn property, and to possibly to re-look at the monies for the Mahaffey Farm.
Okay, I would do this separate, and
okay.
I think you guys can just, or Debbie can.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman.
Don't worry about the Mahaffey Farm.
Yeah, I think if I can work through the CPA administrator, she did email me today put in writing what the vote was by the CPC, so that I would have it in my file. So if I think we just, that's evolving. When we have a draft of the warrant article, certainly if town council has some changes and things, it would be beneficial for the CPC to meet and discuss that. I will certainly make sure that it gets to them through their administrator, Karen O'Donnell. But in the meantime, if we could get the funding to pay for the appraisal so I can get that under.
I'll
give you the motion, for the $3,400 requested.
As soon as possible, the meeting of the CPC. Motion has been made and seconded to request the CPC have a meeting as soon as possible to approve the paying for the appraisal of the property. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay. Next thing on the agenda is the minutes of the Board of Selectmen meeting for September 12, 2016, a meeting held at the Town Hall at 7 p.m. Everybody had a chance to review it?
I'll give you a motion.
I'll second.
Motion has been made and seconded to approve the minutes of the Board of Selectmen meeting for September 12, 2016. All those in favor say aye.
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 Abstain.
Okay. That takes care of our agenda items. We have announcements. The information on the Pine Grove School project is available on the town's website at www.townofraleigh.net. We're having a special town meeting on Monday, November 14th, 2016 at 7:30 p.m. at the Pine Grove School. There's a household hazard waste collection event for Raleigh residents on November 19th, 2016 at the Highway Department Garage. The town's website has tips from the Massachusetts Emergency Management Agency on how to protect your property from hurricane damage. Go to www.townofraleigh.net for helpful tips for homeowners and boat owners. The Raleigh Water Department has set a mandatory water ban in place. Outdoor watering is not permitted. That's a 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. No outdoor watering at all. The Water Department customer billing cycle will change effective November 1st, 2016. Meters will be read on or about the first of every month. Details on the change are posted on the town's website, www.townofraleigh.net. The town has the following vacancies: fence viewer, 3 positions, wood, lumber, and bark inspector, zoning board of appeals associate, 2 seats, parks and recreation committee, 1 seat, Deputy Shellfish Constable, 2 positions. For more information on these positions, please contact the Selectman's Office at 948-2372. The Raleigh Food Pantry is closed for renovations and is scheduled to reopen on October 4th. That's Tuesday, October 4th. The Raleigh Food Pantry will open after renovations. Food assistance is available by leaving a telephone message at the food pantry at 978 238 6264.
Just one additional announcement, Mr. Chairman, that the, just for the information of the board and the residents, the new parking lot at the annex was opened today. It's been completed and lined. There's 19 additional parking spaces at this point.
19?
At the annex. We've asked the employees to park in the back to make room for the elderly and people coming in to use the various inspectors' offices on School Street. And Pat Snow and the Highway Department is going to do some other peripheral work over there, which we really had to cut corners when we didn't have enough money to do the whole project. But the parking lot itself come up beautifully. If you get a chance, take a walk over there, and or take a ride by there, and it come out good. So,
thank you.
That's one done.
One done. Yes, it did. I went by. They hadn't put the lines down, but they had finished the parking lot, and it really looked good. Thank you very much, Dave.
Any other? Motion to adjourn?
Motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you very much.